The only time we see clearly is when we're focused on Jesus. Otherwise, our vision is blurred. And Father, I want to pray that as we go into part two of the Vision Focus series, I pray, Lord Jesus, that you will speak to us. I pray, God, that as our eyes are fixed on you, you will change our lives, you will change our hearts. God, I pray that tonight decisions will be made in all of our hearts that will change the course of our year. And the decisions that we put into place this year, may they change the trajectory of our lives, Lord, because your word is powerful. Your word is powerful, and we pray for changed hearts, for every one of us, for changed hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. So our vision for the year is focus. If you missed part one, I encourage you to catch up on it on the app. Please don't miss out. But I'm going to give you a quick recap before we go on. So previously on focus. You can have the best vision in the world, but it will be blurry until your eyes do the action of focusing. I said you can have 20/20 vision when you climb into a car, but unless you do the work of focusing on the road, you're not going to get home. You're probably going to end up in a crash. Vision is great, but until you focus, good vision will take you nowhere. But by definition, when you focus on something, I said it means to make it the center of your interest and the center of your attention and activity. Just like focusing requires our eye muscles to perform an action. You know, when you focus, when you can have vision, but your eyes put to work when the eye muscles bend the lens to make you focus. And so focusing requires an action of your eye muscles, and focusing on Jesus requires an action from believers. We can't just see Jesus. We can't just have a vision of him. Many people do, but few follow him. I said Judas saw Jesus just like the other 11 disciples, but he didn't really focus on Jesus. He was focusing on money. We've got to not just see Jesus with our eyes, with a great vision of him. We've got to focus on him. We need to fix our eyes on him, which means we've got to allow ourselves to begin to perform the action of following him and following his commands. Salvation, we know we receive by grace through faith in Jesus, but we are saved by grace through faith to do good works. And we are told in the scriptures to put our faith into practice by living out God's commands. And those who focus on Jesus and live out his commands, we said, they are blessed. Jesus spoke about a blessing if you put his words into action. James reiterated saying that we are blessed when we put his words into action. We are blessed. Today, my message is called Feed Your Focus. We want to look deeper at this concept of focusing, and I want to talk today about feeding your focus. I want to welcome the sites who will be joining us by video cast. It's great to have you with us, and we're going to talk today about feeding the things that cause you to focus on Jesus. Focusing on Jesus means you're making the center of your activity. We're going to feed the things that cause us to focus. In other words, the things that keep us living in his ways. There are things we can do that will cause us and help us and enable us to keep living in his ways and living in the blessing he's called us to. The Holy Spirit enables us to keep living in his ways. We've got to sow to the Spirit. Regularly reading the Word of God helps to feed our focus on Jesus. Staying in proximity to other believers, what you're doing tonight and in Connect Group, that type of thing feeds our focus. And I'll mention a few more later. We've got to feed these things that help us stay focused on Jesus. And we've got to watch out for the distractions that take us off course. And I want you to win. You know, I am so desperate that every harvester will win this year. And we're gonna learn who wants to win. Because the Word of God is if we will live it out, we can win. And before I talk about feeding the things that cause us to focus on Jesus, I've got to talk about distractions, because distractions can cause us to lose focus. And I want you to be aware of the wiles of the devil who wants you to lose focus this year. Before we can talk about focus, we need to look at distractions. And there is no better example of this, no better example of the danger of distractions than the true story of the death of the Red Baron. And now, just when you might have been zoning out, I've got your interest again. The death of the Red Baron. Manfred von Richthofen, otherwise known as the Red Baron, was a famous World War I German fighter pilot. It's all true what I'm about to share. Famous World War I German fighter pilot. There was a group of fighter pilots in the war. They were called the Aces. They were the top fighters. They were the ones you didn't want to come up against in a dogfight because they were really good. And the Red Baron was known as the Ace of Aces. He was the Ace of Aces. If you were an Allied fighter pilot and you got into a dogfight with the Red Baron, it would probably be your last. And he would probably be the last person you would see in, if you saw him coming at all, because he was that good. He was officially credited with 80 air combat victories. So 80 times he went into dogfights with gunfire all around, and he came out victorious 80 times. There have been books written about him, movies made about his life, even computer games about him. Years ago, in the, as I say, the late 1900s, about 95, maybe around there, when computer games were coming on the scene, I was big into computers, and games came out with great graphics and sound, and one of the first computer games that came out and became my favorite game was called The Red Baron. I realized now in the game that I was actually flying for Germany, but we'll just forget about that. Be that as it may, it was a fun game. Yeah, it's like when I played this other game and realized only after watching Star Wars that actually I was flying for the dark side, and that also wasn't a good thing. But anyway, I was flying for Germany, I loved the game, but this is the point. Manfred von Richthofen, the Red Baron. 80 victories, 80 kills, but it's his attempt at number 81 that I want to look at today. It's about going too long, too far, and too low. The story goes like this, a true story. The day was April 21, 1918. Richthofen led his flight of triplanes to search for British observation craft. An engagement ensued between a flight of Sopwith Camels led by Canadian Royal Air Force pilot Captain Arthur Roy Brown. Brown's friend, Lieutenant Wilfred May, was a rookie on his first offensive patrol. May had been ordered to keep out of combat, but he couldn't resist. He jammed his guns and defenseless headed away from the battle. Richthofen spotted the lone plane and chose it for kill number 81. Brown observed the scene below him and dove to help his fellow airman, knowing that May was no match for Richthofen. It was then, with Brown closing from behind, that Richthofen, usually a meticulous and a disciplined fighter pilot, made a mistake and broke one of his own rules by following May too long, too far, too low into enemy territory. 2 miles behind the Allied lines, as Brown caught up with Richthofen and fired, the chase that was going on passed over the machine gun nests of Australian field artillery. So it took him straight over Allied forces. And the debate continues over who fired the fatal shot that passed through Richthofen's torso. Ultimately, it doesn't matter whether he was hit from the air or the ground. The Red Baron was mortally wounded. Richthofen was good, probably overconfident, but he broke one of his own rules. Maybe in his mind he was just stretching the rule a bit, or he was distracted by something that appeared to be too good to be true. Whatever the case, he compromised his own standards, which led to his demise. For the Red Baron, the distraction of number 81 was too much. So the Red Baron was distracted by this lone plane. He chases after it, looking for another kill. He knows it's a mistake, but he sees it and he goes, I'm gonna get this guy. He's on his own. He loses his focus, compromises his own safety standards, follows this distraction for too long, for too far, and for too low, goes right down low into enemy territory, and gets taken out by gunfire. Now, there are some big life lessons here when it comes to keeping our focus and avoiding distractions as believers. You see, the Red Baron compromised what he knew was right. He lost his focus for just a little bit, and he ended up in a very, very dangerous place. And it's the same for us. Distractions take us off course and into enemy fire. 1 Peter 5:8 says, "Watch out for your adversary, the devil. Watch out for him. He's like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour." If you know how lions hunt, they will always look to take out the weaker one, won't they? They don't look for the strongest one in the herd. They will look for someone that's isolated, an animal that's isolated and weak, and they'll go for that. And that's what the devil does. He looks for those who are vulnerable. And the Bible says, be careful. Watch out. He's looking for someone you can devour. We don't have to fall for his tricks. We don't have to be lured away by him. But it can happen and does happen to believers, and that's why we are told to watch out. You see, the enemy, he doesn't take us out with one big blow. He's not that powerful. Do you know that? He needs to lure us slowly into a place where we leave the protection we have and we expose ourselves to bigger gunfire. We have been given a will, and our will can take us as born-again believers right into the devil's camp, right into a dangerous place. And then we take hits in this dangerous place. And we come back and we say, God, where were you? And I feel like God wants to say back, no, where were you? Where did you go? I had you in this place of protection, an environment to keep you safe, and you left. You were lured away. Where did you go to? And so the devil knows, he knows that he's got to take us on a journey. He doesn't just come in, as I said, with a devil with horns and tries to prod us. We'll run away as quick as we can. He comes slowly and he puts these distractions that try to lure us away and into a place where it's more dangerous, where we can be exposed to bigger gunfire. Just like what happened with the Red Baron, taking us into a danger zone. People don't fall away overnight. It's a slow fade. It happens with a decision to follow a distraction that we've been presented with. And before we know it, we've gone too long, too far, and too low. And we're exposed to gunfire God never intended us to be exposed to. The Red Baron began chasing number 81, by the way, with a justifiable decision that says it appeared to be good and true. But he knew what he was doing chasing after that lone plane. He knew it was against his principles and what was right and safe, but he did it anyway. He knew he was allowing himself, he consciously knew he was allowing himself to lose focus for a moment, but he justified that decision, and we do that ourselves, don't we? I've been guilty of that. That decision led him further and further off course into enemy territory, and then it was too late. You see, many of the decisions which distract us, many of the things that we allow to distract us, begin at a point where we do things that we justify. And we say, it's okay. Let me give you some examples. You know you shouldn't be watching that movie. But you say to yourself, I'm tired. I need something to take my mind off things. And there's nothing else to watch. And if I don't watch something now, then I'm going to be tired tomorrow and I need a break. And so you justify it. And you say, well, I'm 36 and the movie is rated 16. I'm 20 years over the age limit. So of course I can watch it. And you begin to justify it. You know there's nothing illegal about this. But here's the thing. There's a lot of ungodly stuff in those movies, and so not everything that is legal is permissible. It's legal to do many things in this country. It doesn't mean it's right according to the Word of God. And so we allow ourselves to go down a path. And so you watch it against your better judgment, and this movie takes your mind down a path it shouldn't go, and it takes you into a place where the enemy begins to take bigger shots at you because you're exposed. And he puts some bigger firepower on you, and you end up in a place that you don't want to be. You know you should be declaring something on your tax return. But you remind yourself of all the corruption in the country. You say, well, I'm not going to declare that because it's my hard-earned money and they're probably going to mismanage the money anyway. So I'm going to be, you begin to become very like very justified. I'm going to be like Robin Hood. I'm going to rob from the rich and help a poor family, your own poor family. We do these things, and then you do that once, you do it twice, and before you know it, you're cooking the tax, and it leads to other things, and then money begins to take control of your life. And then the enemy brings out the big guns, and he begins to use your love of mammon to do some more damage in your life. That's what happens. It starts with a little distraction. You know you should forgive someone, but you allow yourself a few more days of bitterness, and you say, oh, I deserve to be bitter for a while. I deserve to be angry and bitter and unforgiving towards this person because of what they did. But the thing is that those few days of bitterness that you allow yourself are a distraction. The enemy is presenting you with this distraction because he wants to lure you away. Why? Because if you take the bait, if you follow that distraction, you're going to lose focus on Jesus. Why? Because you'll battle to pray because you know you're walking in unforgiveness. You won't read your Bible because it convicts you. And so that process continues. And then a week can turn into 2 weeks. And before you know it, you're deep into enemy territory. And the devil then brings out the bigger guns and begins to take you out because you're in a vulnerable place. I want to say to you today with all the love in my heart this year, guys, let's not take the bait of the devil. Let's not take the bait. He wants us to win. Jesus wants us to win. My final observation is this. The Red Baron was the superior fighter. But he was distracted long enough to allow the weaker enemy to take him out. He ended up losing even though he was the stronger enemy. He was the ace of aces. There was no reason why this rookie fighter should have caused his death, but because he was the stronger fighter. But he stayed. He didn't stay the course, let me say, and he lost. Here's the important point. The superior fighter lost to a weaker adversary because of loss of focus. I'll say that again. The superior fighter lost to a weaker adversary because of loss of focus. That's what we learn from the Red Baron's death. We are on the winning side, guys. We are the stronger fighter, hands down, because the word says, if God is for us, who can stand against us? You know that you are the ace of aces when it comes to fighting the devil. Why? Because the Spirit of God lives inside of you. You're the stronger one. You're the stronger adversary. You're the Red Baron in this example. The devil is weaker than us because of Jesus. He is the weaker adversary. But here's the thing. If we lose focus long enough and chase after the distractions that he presents us with, then we, the stronger fighters, we can be taken into the enemy camp and become isolated and vulnerable, and we can be taken out. You are the superior fighter. Do not let the weaker adversary cause you to lose focus. Don't follow his distractions, because you're the stronger one. Jesus didn't die and rise again so that you could lose. Did you know that? He rose again so that you could win. He rose again so that his power could come through the Holy Spirit, that you could overcome the evil one. But you don't have to be subject to the sinful nature. He wants you to win. He enabled you to win. So how do we avoid losing focus, and how do we proof ourselves against getting distracted? And the way you do it is you've got to feed your focus and you've got to starve your distractions. Feed your focus and starve your distractions. I read that saying somewhere, and it's unclear who originally wrote it. But you know how it goes. The first time you quote it, you reference the person who said it. The second time, you just say it. And the third time, you claim it as your own and people think you said it. That's pretty much what happens. I don't know who said this, but many motivational speakers have said this. Feed your focus and starve your distractions. Many of the things they say are not based on Scripture. This one is. And I'm going to read Galatians 5, verse 16 to 17, and show you how that saying I read links back to the Scriptures. It says, live by the Spirit, I say, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. For what the flesh desires is opposed to the Spirit, and what the Spirit desires is opposed to the flesh. For these are opposed to each other to prevent you from doing what you want. And then, still in Galatians, but jumping down to chapter 6, Galatians 6, verse 8, it says, whoever sows to please their flesh, from the flesh will reap destruction. Whoever sows to please the Spirit, from the Spirit will reap eternal life. Saying there are things you can do which please the flesh, and those things will cause death in your life. But if you sow to please the Spirit, then you're going to get eternal life. So first in Galatians 5:17, it says there's this war going on inside you between your flesh man and your spirit man. And then it goes on in Galatians 6:8, it's the same train of thought, the same concept. It says if you sow or feed the flesh, you sow to or feed the flesh, then the flesh is going to produce destruction. But if you sow to the Spirit, if you feed the Spirit, then from the Spirit, you're going to reap eternal life. So you need to focus on the things that help you. Well, you need to feed the things, let me say, that help you focus on Jesus. You've got to feed those things, and you need to starve the things that distract you. These are the things of the flesh. Feed your focus and starve your distractions. I love the way Romans 13:14 puts it in the New American Standard Bible. It says, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh in regard to its lust. It's saying make no provision for the flesh. Speaking to believers, it says, believers, make no provision for the flesh. Food provisions, if you have them, then you're able to keep going and you're able to keep growing. What happens when you take these provisions away? Well, you starve. And so when you take provisions away, then there's starvation that happens. And that's what it's saying. It says, make no provision for the flesh. Starve the flesh. Make the flesh weak. Then it won't control you. Feed your focus and starve your distractions. I want to read again from Galatians 5 from the New Living Translation. And we're going to read that whole passage now. It says, so I say, let the Holy Spirit guide your lives. Then you won't be doing what your sinful nature craves. The sinful nature wants to do evil, which is just the opposite of what the Spirit wants. And the Spirit gives us desires that are the opposite of what the sinful nature desires. These two forces are constantly fighting each other, so you're not free to carry out your good intentions. And then he gives the answer. How do you win this battle? He says, when you are directed by the Spirit, you are not under obligation to the law of Moses. When you follow the desires of your sinful nature, the results are clear. Sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, quarreling. I love the way many of us go, oh, I'm not guilty of any of that. And then you start to get hostility, quarreling, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, dissension, division, envy, drunkenness, wild parties, and other sins. It puts them all together. It says, this is the result of sowing to the sinful nature. Let me tell you again, as I have before, he says, that anyone living that sort of life will not inherit the kingdom of God. It's not saying you can't be forgiven of those sins, but if that becomes your lifestyle, you're in big trouble. And then it goes on to say this, it says, but the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in your lives. The flesh produced that kind of fruit. The Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against these things. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have nailed the passions and desires to their sinful nature, of the sinful nature of the cross, and crucified them there. Since we are living by the Spirit, let us follow the Spirit's leading in every part of our lives. I feel like we need to read that scripture over and over every day, because there's so many keys to this life he's called us to in there. Down to chapter 6, because the thought continues there. It says, don't be misled. You cannot mock the God of justice, the justice of God. You will always harvest what you plant. Those who only live to satisfy their own sinful nature will harvest decay and death from that sinful nature. But those who live to please the Spirit will harvest everlasting life from the Spirit. So let's not get tired of doing what is good. At just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing if we don't give up. To help explain this text, I want to use an analogy with fruit trees. I want you to picture two fruit trees in the garden of your life. Imagine in the garden, imagine an orange tree and a lemon tree. Now every illustration, every analogy is flawed, but just stay with me on this one. I want you to picture an orange tree and a lemon tree. For the sake of my illustration, the lemon tree represents the flesh man, the sinful nature, because lemon trees produce sour lemons. Now, I know that lemons go great with certain things, but the reality is if you give a child a lemon, they're not going to want to choose the lemon. They're going to want the orange. We don't like to eat lemons. And we talk about life producing lemons. Now, some lemons in our life happen because of no doing of our own, but some of us grow lemons because of what we do. And I'll talk about that now. But lemons represent the bad stuff. And I also thought about it. People, like in these really rough bars, they use lemons to drink tequila and that. So think bad stuff about lemons for a moment. I know if you like lemons, just they're bad in my illustration. For the sake of my illustration, the orange tree represents the Spirit, producing sweet fruit, the fruit of the Spirit. The Scripture is saying we need to sow to the Spirit, we need to feed the Spirit, we need to water the Spirit. Water the tree that produces the fruit that you're looking for. Feed your focus and starve your distractions. Water the tree that produces the oranges and starve the tree. Withhold the water from the tree that produces lemons. When you follow the desires of your sinful nature, the results are very clear. It says in verse 19, you get lemons, you get the bad stuff. It says, but the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. All the good stuff, all the sweet fruit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. That's what the orange tree produces. In my analogy, it's the fruit of the Spirit. He produces that when we water and sow to Him. And God wants us to live with that good stuff. When you read that and you say, God, why do you want me to not do things and why do you want me to do other things? Well, here's the thing. That's the fruit He wants for your life. And He knows how to produce it. Love, joy, peace, patience. We need some peace in our lives. There's a way to produce it. The Holy Spirit produces it. We don't have to be controlled by our sinful nature. We can live this life God's called us to because we have the Holy Spirit empowering us and producing this kind of life. That's why the good news is such good news, because Jesus not only paid the price for our sins, He also enabled us to live righteous lives by the power of the Holy Spirit. All we've got to do is water the Holy Spirit tree that produces this kind of fruit. We've got to starve the flesh, that we've got to do. We've got to water the tree, we've got to sow to the Spirit, and then the fruit grows. Water the tree that produces the oranges and starve the tree that produces the lemons. If you're not experiencing and haven't experienced this amazing fruit, 2020 can be the year you begin to experience this fruit in your life. You've just got to start watering the right tree. It's as simple as that and as difficult as that in some ways. There are times through our own choices we allow the flesh to become strong and the flesh begins to control our thoughts and our actions and our behavior. And we reap the consequences of that. It's a bad harvest. It's lemons. It's no peace. It's no joy. But as soon as we water the Spirit again, as soon as we water that orange tree, so to speak, the Spirit will dominate. He will control our thoughts, our actions, and our behavior. And then we can confidently expect a different harvest in our lives, a harvest of blessing and spiritual fruit. But we need to feed the things that help us to focus on Jesus and starve the things that distract us. Fruit of the Spirit is produced by the Holy Spirit. So if we want that fruit, we've got to water that tree. If you have an actual orange tree and an actual lemon tree in your garden, and you only have one watering can of water a day, can you picture that? You've got two trees in your garden. You're not allowed to water with municipal water at the moment here in PE. So some kind person with a borehole drops a watering can off at your front door every morning, and it's to look after your trees. But you only got one watering can. If you want oranges, you will use your quota of water to water the orange tree every day. If you want oranges. If you keep watering the lemon tree and ignoring the orange tree, don't be surprised when the orange tree withers and you get a harvest of lemons in your garden. If you want the fruit of the Spirit, you've got to water the tree that produces the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Do the things that sow to the Spirit, and then His fruit will grow in your lives. If you keep feeding the flesh is going to get stronger and you're going to get sour lemons. I said there's a difference between vision and focus. You can see Jesus, but we can't just see Him. We can't just have a vision of Him. We need to focus on Him, which means He needs to become the center of our activity, the center of our watering and feeding activity. There are many Christians who walk out every day and they empty their watering can onto the lemon tree day after day, while telling everyone that the orange tree is the most important tree in their garden. So they're standing there, and we've all done this, guys. That's why we encouraged by the Word not to do this. But you stand there watering the lemon tree and telling everyone, look at my orange tree. This is the important tree in my garden. But you're putting all the water on the lemon tree. It sounds crazy, but we do that. And the world eats lemons, and we eat lemons while we're gazing at the idea of this orange tree. We only have so much time in the day. This is what I'm trying to say. There are only so many things that can have our attention. Our time and attention is like a watering can, a quota of water. We get one per day and you choose where you pour it out. When you put all your time into feeding the flesh will grow and produce lemons. When you sow to the Spirit will grow and you'll get to eat oranges, and so will those around you. You can't just like the idea of an orange tree. You've got to actually water it. You've got to choose to put your water there. So what does it practically mean to water the lemon tree or water the orange tree? What does it practically mean to sow to the flesh or sow to the Spirit? Sowing to the flesh means doing the things that feed or satisfy it. And when you feed something, it grows stronger and stronger, and we don't want that. So how do we feed the flesh? God's dropped a few examples into my heart. And many of these things I'm going to share, in themselves they're not sinful, but they can become sinful. Right? So watching TV is not sinful, it's what you watch. There's some great inspiring stuff out there. We just got to choose what we watch. And so that's the first thing that can feed our flesh. We're looking at things that distract us, that feed the flesh and cause us to produce the wrong kind of fruit, produce those lemons. What are those things? I really believe in this modern age, movies and video content is high up on that list. As a believer, just because you're 18 doesn't mean you can watch something that's 18 rated. If you're a believer and you're 118, you can't watch some of that stuff. Because there are things in there that will affect your life. Ephesians 5:11 says, have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather expose them. Have nothing to do with darkness. Don't do the things that belong to the kingdom of darkness, and don't watch people doing it. It says have nothing to do with it. When you expose yourself to the bad language, to the sexual scenes, to the conversations that go on, to the immoral lifestyle, what you're doing is this. You are pouring big buckets of water on your lemon tree, and you're making it stronger. Those things feed the flesh, and the lemon tree is going to grow, and it's going to produce lemons. You've got to watch what you watch. You've got to avoid this dangerous distraction. The other thing is be careful of willfully putting yourself into ungodly environments on purpose to feed the flesh. There are parties and things that people go to, that believers go to, and the music that plays, the way people dress, the worldly spirit. It's dangerous, and you must be careful. Here's the thing. Unless you're going into those environments in outreach mode and prayed up, be very careful. Many believers, I've had friends and they said, well, we're going into those places to witness to people. They were going in not to witness, but to be part of what they were doing. And it was a distraction and they got sucked in and some of them are not serving Jesus today. I want to warn you, be careful of some of these environments. There's a big difference between going into those places with a purpose and just going in to be part of it. Those are environments that water the lemon tree and make it hard for you to live this life Jesus is calling you to. Number three is music. Certain music can also feed your flesh. And look, here's the thing. I'm touching on some very touchy things tonight. But I'm not here to be popular. I'm here because I love you. And I want you to win this year. And I've been living for 41 years. I know how things work and I know how these things affect you. I made a decision once in my life to listen to unsecular music. And just that one decision, because I liked the music, took me away from Jesus for 6 months. I didn't completely backslide, but I know that that music affected my life. And here's the revelation that I've had with music. I believe God showed this to me a while ago. Worship songwriters, they have an experience with God. I know because I've written worship songs. You have an experience with God. And from that experience, you write a song. And every time people sing that song, it recreates that moment with God. That song that was written, Let Your Glory Fall. Someone had a powerful quiet time and met with God and wrote that song. I mean, we sang it tonight. His presence came. It recreated that moment. And then the Lord showed me this. He said, people have an experience with the world. Anger, lust, revenge, and so on. Out of that experience, they write a song. And very often when that song plays, the spirit behind which the song was created is recreated in your car or at home. Just ask people to listen to Taylor Swift. Every time she breaks up with someone, she writes a song about that. People listen to the song, all the girls break up with their boyfriends. That's what happens. What? Music has a spirit behind it. It's powerful. And I'm not saying that all secular music is bad. I'm saying be careful. Because some of that secular music is pouring buckets of water on the lemon tree. And it's going to produce lemons. And before is overexposure to social media. Here's a classic example of something that's not sin in itself. Some distractions are not wrong, but they become wrong when you spend too much time in them. Social media is not a sin. Social media is not evil in itself. If you want to call social media evil, then you've got to call books evil too, because reading is not evil, but reading the wrong kind of book is not good. Are you following me? In itself, it's not evil. But if you spend an inordinate amount of time on social media, you will become distracted. It will cause you to lose focus, and it could take you into sin, jealousy, envy, all those kinds of things. If you're feeding social media too much, if you're giving it too much water and starving time in the Word and prayer, and quite honestly, time with other real people and the believers, then social media is going to overpower you and control your life. If your time is like a quota of water in a watering can, don't pour it all out on social media. Leave some water for the orange tree so that it can grow. Feed your focus and starve your distractions. We can read 100 Facebook posts with your vision, but it will leave you empty, discouraged, and distracted. Or you can just read one chapter of Scripture a day and change your life. I'm not saying you've got to give up social media. Just leave some water for the orange tree. The last thing, very quickly, computer games. Parents, I want to ask you this with all the love in my heart. Please don't let your kids pour all their water onto video games. Those things, it's also too much of it. It becomes a distraction as well. Leave some time in their diaries for other things, for other healthy things. There are many things we could go. We'll reveal what those are. That's sowing to the flesh. That's feeding the flesh. Very quickly, as we come to a close, what does it practically mean to sow to the Spirit? What does it practically mean to water the orange tree? One of the ways, and we're doing it this year, is to go through this reading plan. Reading the Word. Reading the Word, and I'm about to show you, has been scientifically proven to change your life. And to water that orange tree and produce the kind of things you want in your life. Let's just watch this video. It's a very short video. It's between John Bevere and someone from Logos. It is a reputable company. It's a solid research. Just listen to what this said just for a moment.
There was a recent study by the Center for Bible Engagement where they pulled 40,000 general population in the U.S. from 8 to 80, and they just wanted to see how we are engaging with Scripture.
Right.
And they discovered something that actually became kind of the profound discovery of the entire study. They weren't even looking for this, and this is kind of became the highlight of the study.
Right.
when we're in the scripture one time a week, and that could be church on Sunday, that's pastor saying you open your Bible, we hear the message, one time a week had negligible effect on some key areas of your life. So I'm going to spell that out more here in a moment. Two times a week, negligible effect. Now, at three times a week, there was a blip on the map. Like, there was a heartbeat. Something happened. Again, a heartbeat.
Okay.
But here was a profound discovery. When we're in the scripture four times a week, it literally spikes off the chart. You would expect that it'd be one, two, there'd be a gradual incline on the effect and impact that would have in your life, but it was literally one, two, three, four, something radically happens.
Okay, you got my curiosity.
To this extent.
What kind of behavior is being affected?
Feeling lonely drops 30%.
Wow. Four times a week in the Bible.
Four times a week in the Bible.
Okay.
Anger issues drop 32%. Bitterness in relationships, marriage, a relationship with your kids, and so on, drops 40%. Alcoholism drops 57%. Feeling spiritually stagnant. You know, if there was one area when I'm talking with people that they'll be honest about is they just feel spiritually stagnant. Ask them the question, how much time are you spending in scripture? If they're in the scripture four times a week or more, it drops 60%.
Wow.
Viewing pornography drops 61%.
That's very important.
Now, on a flip positive side, sharing your faith jumps 200%.
Wow.
Because you have a confidence in God's word. And then discipling others jumps 230%.
That's amazing right there.
Four times a week in the scripture, we're going to try for five together as a church. The research shows it will have an effect on your life. That's a foregone conclusion. We've got to spend time in prayer. That's sowing to the Spirit, watering the orange tree, asking, refreshing fillings of the Holy Spirit, worshiping song, keeping the right company. The Bible says don't forsake the gathering of the saints. As you come into connect group, as you come to church, you are surrounding yourself with people that will help you and that will water that orange tree. The red baron got caught alone in unprotected enemy territory. Don't end up isolated and vulnerable. Guys, I want to end by saying this as the band comes up. Trying harder didn't work for the Israelites. It's not going to work now. We are unable to live righteously by just trying harder. We've got to water the tree that produces the fruit. We've got to spend time in things that cause us to focus on Jesus, and the Holy Spirit will produce that fruit in our life. Put the effort into sowing to please the Spirit, then watch as He produces that fruit. Put the effort into what? Obeying His promptings, reading the Word, spending time in prayer, worshiping in song, asking God for fresh fillings, and spending time with other believers in church and in connect group. Would you close your eyes? Father, I want to thank You that You have not given us an impossible task. And God, more than that, there is life, there is peace, there is hope, there is joy, there is self-control. There are all kinds of wonderful things that You want us to live in. Because You love us. And if there's one thing I want to say to you today, I really feel it's the word of God to you. He wants to say this to you. He says, you can win. You can win. We've just got to put our effort into the right things. And we can win and we will win. And I want you to make a decision as we close out with one last song. Would you decide in your heart now? Would you make some decisions this year to starve some of the things that are causing you to go off course, that are causing distractions in your life? I'm not saying you have to give these things up, but you have to begin to analyze some of the things in your life. Have a look at the fruit. If it's not good fruit, start to say, God, where am I watering a lemon tree? And make some changes. God's going to show that His Holy Spirit's going to reveal that. He's not going to condemn you. He's going to just show you and He's going to enable you to do that. But you've got to make that choice. That's the action. That's your part. And I want you to, on the other side, then choose to do the things that are going to water the orange tree and produce the fruit that you want in your life. These decisions you make now can change the course of your year, but more than that, it can change the trajectory of your life. And that's what God wants for us. Would you stand as we close out in one last song, and would you just, in your own heart, make those decisions? Thank you.